So, welcome to our first ever Last on the Brakes podcast from India to Ducati Corsi Sporting Director Paolo Cibatti. Thank you for joining us, Paolo. We're going to start with, as I was just asking you when you arrived, easy first question. You've been in India a few days.
Yep.
You said you'd seen a place that was always a dream of yours to visit.
Yeah.
What have you been doing in the run-up to this first Grand Prix before arriving at the track?
Well, first of all, it's a pleasure to be part of this podcast. And yes, I came here on Saturday afternoon. So I spent one night in New Delhi having dinner with my friends of Ducati India. We have a subsidiary here who is very active and promoting the sales. And then I left next morning to go to Rajasthan. It was on my bucket list. So I wanted to see that city, and especially there is a beautiful hotel on the lake called the Lake Palace. If you remember a Roger Moore, James Bond movie, Octopussy. Yeah, Octopussy used to live there. So
if anyone's playing podcast bingo, I don't think they would have had Octopussy on the list.
But anyways, age probably it's something. But yes, so I wanted to go there. I was spending a couple of days, had the chance to go a little bit around the countryside, and well, I loved a lot, except the weather was a little bit rainy, too much, but I enjoyed anyway. And then I came back to Delhi and did some promotional events.
I was going to say, like you said, obviously Ducati, big manufacturer globally. In India, also a key market for motorcycle racing, for the motorcycle sector, and of course Ducati. Now you're kings of the world in pretty much every table as well. It's a great opportunity for you guys, isn't it, to have this event and to have this massive presence for MotoGP in India this year?
Sure. I mean, it's very important, even though, as you can imagine, the market for premium bikes is quite small. So we have a good share of that market, but the numbers are not that big. But the bikers community, I mean, you can see on the roads, it's just everybody is riding a kind of moped, scooter, or
but
so
everyone
on.
In helmets as well.
Depending where.
I've been impressed. There's a
yeah. Well, if you go to Rajasthan, you will be impressed that nobody's actually almost wearing an helmet. But anyways, well, we understand that it's a way to commute for most of people who cannot afford a car here. But anyway, there is a strong connection with motorcycles, and it's a good opportunity to be here. I was actually visiting this circuit in 2018. We came here
with Andrea
Dovizioso, yeah. And there was a Ducati event, and I could see that such a fantastic structure was a little bit of a shame that it was built with the dream of having Formula One for many years, and then Formula One was here only for 3 years. Then for whatever reason, they decided not to come. And I think it's really good to be back with our event. Let's hope it's going to be also a success in terms of spectators. I'm sure that everybody I met in the bikers community is super excited.
There's a lot of people, even just people like me, low-level random people. I've had more LinkedIn requests this week with people getting so excited the event has come in than I have for the last 5 years. But yeah, like you say, it's a really impressive track, isn't it? Mm-hmm. I watch Formula One. I'm a big fan of that sport as well. Obviously, have seen the races here. I first think of Sebastian Vettel doing donuts at this track. Mm-hmm. I hope we will replace that with some exciting motorcycle images this weekend. But the pit building, or the main grandstand when you come in, with the color of the flags as well in the seats, it's really cool. I wasn't quite expecting the scale of it.
Well, as soon as you get in the circuit itself, there is this long road taking to the building and so on, so it looks like a majestic kind of building.
It appears, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, it's cool. So as I said, shame that it wasn't used for any international event for so long, and hopefully we will be here to stay for many more years. And as I said, it's good. I think there were a lot of complications linked to this trip because of some logistic problems, as you know, and some bureaucratic problems. But in the end, we're all here and looking forward to be on the track from tomorrow and hopefully give some exciting races on Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah, we hope so. I keep forgetting as well, we have our Tissot Sprint on Saturday. I'm excited. Yeah. I get excited every Saturday at like 2:30, and I remember it's coming.
Yeah.
But yeah, this week it's a little bit later. We've got both at 3:30, yeah. So you're going to have similar weather, which could be interesting, or similar track conditions, hopefully. Yeah. The layout then, yesterday, Fabio Quartararo and Franco Morbidelli visited Yamaha Motor India, and Fabio said very clearly he doesn't think it will suit their bike very much. Do you think it will suit your bike? You've got some long straights, accelerations?
In principle, yes. There is, I think, a very long straight, and this should be favorable. Let's see the level of grip of the surface, obviously. We know that if a level of grip is low, normally Aprilia has an advantage, we could see in Barcelona. But all in all, I think it's suiting the characteristics of our bike. We hope so. And we're going to find out tomorrow.
Is there any track now in 2023 that doesn't suit the characteristics of your bike?
Well, I don't think so, because we've been basically on the podium everywhere and fighting for the top positions everywhere. So I think overall our bike is now capable of being competitive everywhere. The best example, I would say, is Sachsenring. You know, Sachsenring never...
That was always your nightmare track.
was a nightmare track, and this year we put like 8 bikes in the first 9 positions, so I think it was just...
Oh, yeah, was that the race where there was only Jack?
Yeah.
It was a Ducati Armada and then just Jack near the top.
So, I mean, yeah, I think we must be proud of what we achieved. Obviously, it's... you know, thanks to the work of all the engineers and Gigi, but also important to say that all riders, even if they are different in riding styles, they can find a way to be very fast and competitive with our bike. So we're happy. You know, first, second, and third in the championship, I think, is also showing that we are in the moment the manufacturer with the most competitive bike.
I think everyone would agree.
Yeah.
But let's talk about that journey then. You touched on it there. It's been quite a long one. I remember the image I always have in my head of kind of the more difficult few seasons you had before you rebuilt as Ducati was that last lap, last corner, or near the end of the lap. Dovi and Nicky Hayden,
Indianapolis,
bunny hopping together.
Yeah, for whatever it was, like
11th
position or something.
Yeah, yes. I always think of that because I love the fact they still tried. I'm sure from your perspective, you'd rather maybe they didn't. But it's been an incredible kind of project in a few years for you. What's it been like from your perspective within the team and within the factory?
Well, as you may know, I was working for Ducati from 1997 to 2007. Then I left the company. I went to manage World Superbike for the promoters. But then halfway through 2012, two things happened. One, Audi bought Ducati from Invest Industrial, and they wanted some changes to be done in the racing department. On the other side, Ducati was in the second year of a quite unsuccessful partnership with Valentino. I think the Valentino-Ducati partnership was something everybody expected to be a huge success, you know, the most successful and iconic Italian rider with, you know, the Italian sports motorcycle. So there was a lot of, lot of expectation, and unfortunately for whatever reason, it just didn't work. And so, you know, when I got the call, it was in a moment when I said, okay, maybe I want to get this chance and try MotoGP. So I said, yeah, I'm interested. And then I said, okay, I will join from next year. But at that time, things were still not so clear about who will do what in Ducati courses. So in the end, 2013 was really a difficult year. I think Ducati engineers tried so much to make to change the bike to make it suitable for Valentino riding style. But you know, when you do that during the season with a lot of pressure, without getting the results, and also you know, everybody looking at a failure, because we should say what it was. It was unfortunately a failure. Then, you know, in the next season, basically, we had a bike which, you know, as you said, would go basically nowhere. And
I didn't quite say that.
Well, but basically, we were like 40 seconds from the winner.
It was so
difficult. And it was a very difficult and challenging first year. So a few times during the season, I say, why did I do it? Because, you know, it's okay, but this is very tough. But luckily then, we managed, thanks to our CEO, Claudio Domenicali, to convince Mr. Dallinia to consider Ducati and to accept the challenge after so many years at Aprilia. And then he said yes, and he joined the team basically on the test on Monday, Tuesday after Valencia of the last race. And 2014 was still difficult because the bike has been basically designed without Gigi's guidance.
It's difficult, isn't it, when someone joins?
Yeah, clearly it's, you know, when you join in November, basically the bike for next year is 99% already done. We made a few changes during the season. We achieved some decent results. And on the podium, for the first time since, you know, at least 2013, I think Valentino was on second in Misano 2012, which was, I think, his best results on a Ducati. But then the brand new bike came out. So the turning point was working in 2014 to design a brand new bike, brand new engine. And this bike, the GP15, actually was debuting in a fantastic way. We almost won the first Grand Prix in, if it was not for Valentino, who won the Qatar Grand Prix, you know, Dovi second, Iannone third. It was an incredible debut. And then from there, we were doing better and better. And the first GP win came in Austria with Iannone in 2016.
It did, and then you took another one with
Sepang with Dovi, rainy conditions.
Two of the 10 winners in a row, was it? 8 winners in a row? I should know. I remember writing about it very clearly, but yeah, an incredible season there. And obviously that season as well, there were so many different winners. I think Pedrosa was the 7th maybe at Misano, then Dovi was definitely the 9th, because I remember our lovely commentator Matt Burt saying Dovi on cloud 9 in a perfect immediate headline.
I remember very well. I was on the podium with him, so I remember very well.
It was a great, great win. But from there, it wasn't just that, you know, it's more unpredictable as a sport. It wasn't anything else that had changed within the sport. It was also the Ducati really had changed.
Yep.
Since then, it seems to have just got better and better and better. How is that now looking back for you when you think about that new bike being born and the expectation, and now you see things like Sachsenring even when you have 7 of the top 8?
Well, obviously, it's we're very proud. As I said, we're very happy about how things turn out. And, you know, 2017, 18, 19 with Dovi, we were always second. And
it was not in last lap battles. Always first.
But as I said, then we came to the point to say, hey, second again, how come? And we were then, you know, in 2017, actually, it was a fantastic season for Andrea. He was still had a chance in the last round to fight with or try to get the championship, but obviously he found Marc Marquez in the best of his form in those years. So we did the best we could. I think we kept working on the bike, improving some weak points like the turning. You could have heard our rider saying the bike is not easy when it comes to turning, but we worked on that. And then we decided at the end of 2020, you know, with COVID, it was a very strange championship in a way. But we decided it was also time to change from Dovi and Danilo, who are, you know, were great riders with us, to new riders. Try to get, you know, some fresh, a different attitude of younger guys who wanted to give their best and maybe come with a little bit fresh, open mind. Obviously, they were already on the Pramac bike, so they knew the Ducati, and we were signing for the factory team Jack and Pecco, and Pecco had really a very good season. You know, it just the last part of that season was just incredible. And
when it clicked,
yes. So we were second again that year. I said, come on, second is not enough. And eventually, then last year, we know the story.
We do. So I want to talk a little bit about Pecco then, because I don't know, compared to some rookies, I don't think Marc Marquez is a fair example for anyone else with the bike that he joined in the year and everything how it was. But looking at Pecco now, you would have expected his rookie season maybe to look more like Jorge Martin's, but it was actually, at least with a win and some poles and stuff, but he actually had a tougher start in MotoGP.
Very tough start for him in 2019, actually.
Why was it that long ago now?
Oh, yes.
I feel like it was last year.
No. And, but you should also remember that in those days, we still had one rider on the factory bike with Pramac and one rider on the previous year's machine.
Yeah.
So Jack was the guy who got the factory bike, and Pecco got the bike from the previous year. And, you know, we brought so many improvements every year in the new bikes that probably you know, it was a difficult rookie season. I don't say the bike was not up to the 2020, but for sure was on a lower level. And, you know, then he had the accident in Brno, he got injured, then, you know, he needed to get surgery to his leg. So it was a difficult, very difficult season for him, and below the expectation for sure, because I think during the winter test in Sepang, he was super fast.
Yeah, he was.
And then, you should never consider Sepang a test like a picture of the whole season, because we've seen also Jorge Lorenzo doing very, very well and then having a difficult season with us. But anyways, good that he kept pushing, we kept pushing, we gave him a factory bike at Pramac the following year, so both him and Jack were on factory bikes. And he did in the second part of the season something which was very good.
He really did. And obviously his season in Moto2 when he won the title, that was kind of what we now recognize immediately as kind of Pecco style. Almost perfect.
Yeah, so smooth. it was. And actually, we were looking on Pecco already in 2008. I think it was 2018. No, 2017, sorry. And because he won 2018, and then we said, okay, let's sign him for 2019 for 2 years plus option. And we met at Ducati headquarters in Bologna with him, and Francesco Guidotti was at that time team manager of Pramac, and we signed him before the championship began. So we said, and then seeing him doing that season in Moto2, we made a right choice. But then 2019 happened, so it was like, okay, you know, in this take time a little bit more, but then, as I said, we are with the Pecco we see now, always fast, always under control, and with a very, very good strategy, and able to work with this team also through difficult beginnings of the weekends. Many times we have a Friday where things don't really work in the way we expect, but you know, they have such a mutual confidence and trust that they can always or almost always come up with a solution for Saturday, and you know, even something better for Sunday.
That has been really impressive, and I think from the outside certainly that seems like something that may play in your favor as well this weekend. When it's a new track, that ability to work together so well and find those solutions so quickly.
Yeah, well, you know, a new track is always a new track, so.
I know, no pressure. No pressure. But so talking more about Pecco, then, last year you finally got that title.
Yep.
And kind of almost the opposite of what we've seen so far this season, where he was chasing. Mm-hmm. What's that like for you guys as well as the team? Obviously for the rider, it's kind of intense pressure at times, I'm sure, huge disappointment, like Germany mid-season when I think it was 91 points.
Yes, exactly, minus 91.
Obviously, it's a different thing for him himself and you guys around him to manage that on the bike. What's it like as a team when you're like, oh, we're so close, and that roller coaster of emotions?
Yeah, you know, it's actually true that we had a few crashes at the beginning of last season, which those zeros were very, very heavy. And we came to the point when after the crash in Germany, we said, okay, minus 91. No one has ever won the championship coming from minus 91. But we just change our mindset. Let's say we do race by race. If you think about the championship, it looks like it's a mountain too high to climb. So let's do it. I think, you know, we know how he's talented. We know the bike is good. So let's see. And then bang, 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 four races in a row. And that also probably connected with some problems that Fabio started to have with the Yamaha, and seeing also that you know, his main main competitor was just closing the gap, made us think, okay, it's possible. But then you remember Japan, that unnecessary crash. We were just like 7 or 8, and even Fabio was not in a much better position. Still said another zero, okay. But, you know, well, finally when he won in Sepang, it was just...
That race was spectacular. The
spectacular
tension was...
Yeah, and you could see some talk between Gigi, Claudio, David, and myself. Obviously, you know, I explained that because everybody said team order, everybody's speaking about team orders. Actually, we didn't give any team orders, but It was a moment when Bezzecchi was fourth, was closing on Fabio,
it
was third.
Like it was all going to change, didn't it?
And obviously, if it would be third, then with Pecco winner, we would get the championship, which is very important for Ducati, because the only world title we won was back in 2015, years before, with Casey Stoner. So we said, what should we do in case, Marco manages to pass Fabio? But then we saw that actually came close, like less than 1 second, and then he started to lose. So we said, okay, let's step and whatever. And Pecco was very, very, I think, good to keep things under control, because Enea was super fast, so he passed him. But I think Pecco saw that Enea did not really have exactly the pace, so he passed him again and won. But you know, that part was just to say, hey, what do we do in case we have a championship in the pocket? In case we have a championship in the pocket, should we just be a super nice sportsman and say let it go, or maybe think about something? Luckily, it was not needed.
It's interesting that you only started thinking about that literally in the race, yeah, as you see Marco doing, yeah, it, and everyone had been saying that you've been doing it since summer.
No, not always. True. I mean, I always said, and people, you know, people might think I'm lying, but I'm not, to tell our riders, please don't take out another Ducati rider trying an over, I would say, the stewards, they say, over-ambitious.
Yeah.
It's nice, over-ambitious. If a rider is not ambitious, how can he win the race? But anyway, an over-ambitious pass. Don't do it on another Ducati rider when, you know they're fighting for the championship. That's the only thing we always said. And never said, you know, to anyone, you should stay behind or whatever. Because in the end, we know a rider, when he has a chance to win, he wants to win. We perfectly understand. As I said, we don't like, I'm sorry to say, because Andrea Iannone is a good friend, but I don't want to see anymore the Iannone Dovizioso thing in the last corner. Okay, this was over-ambitious. That was over-ambitious.
So. That's the one time you'd let the stewards use that.
Yeah, yes, I would let them use. But that's the only thing we don't want to see between Ducati riders.
Yeah, obviously, it's kind of everyone's worst nightmare, either within teams or factories as well. But yeah, so let's talk about your factory kind of layout now, because you've got 8 bikes on the grid.
Mm-hmm.
I remember asking Davide, I think it was last year, like, everyone complains that there's too many Ducatis, and he was like, well, that's not our problem. We give bikes to people who ask for them.
Well,
but it must be quite impressive now. There's 8 of them, going from where you were when you joined the team to now running the world.
Yeah, actually, we used to have 8 bikes, because Pramac was with us, also when Avintia and Aspar had Ducatis. But in those years, the bike we could lease to the team were non-competitive as they are now, because we were leasing GP14 and 15 in those years. So clearly, as Davide said, it's true. I mean, an independent team has to consider what is the best for his interest, how much it is costing, because they have to pay for it, what kind of technical service they get, and what kind of competitive material they get. So at the moment, I mean, I know the other manufacturers might not be happy, but we have a best package in terms of cost, performance, and technical support. As you know, we share data between the 8 riders. It's something which is helping us to further develop the bike. You need to teach the riders that, you know, sometimes you lose something because some of the other Ducati riders will learn something from you, but sometimes you learn from them.
Yeah.
And you know, they all accept and understand. And it's like this. Eventually, there will be some other manufacturer coming up with a better package, or more convenient financially, or whatever. And then the teams will be free to choose it. But as it is today, I think, you know, as I said, independent team want to know, how can I try to win a race? At the moment, the answer is Ducati, because it proved Bezzecchi won 2 races. Okay, Pramac won. They have a factory machine. They are a little bit different because they are factory supported, and we contract their riders. Gresini won a sprint race with Alex Marquez. So I don't see at the moment other manufacturer in that position, and eventually it will be in the future. And it's an open market. It's offer and demand.
It is. It obviously does also mean you're kind of competing with yourselves a little bit at the moment. Mm-hmm. We've got Brad Binder not too far down the table, but at the top it's three Ducati riders. It's also interesting because it's obviously Pecco, your reigning champion. Certainly, I don't want to say lead rider as though you have a one and two, but obviously Ineos had a super difficult year this season with injury and everything else. So you've got Pecco, then you've got Marco, who's made quite a splash and from Argentina on, super impressive. And then you've got Jorge, Martin, sorry to all our listeners. It's not like I'm best friends with them, it's just easier. But it's a very interesting dynamic as well with Jorge versus Enea last year with that factory seat. But like you say, Pramac have factory bikes and support. How do you kind of view that interesting kind of political mix at the top?
Well, first of all, if we wouldn't like this situation to happen, we would not give this level of bikes to the independent teams. So it's something we accept. Obviously, we see more of a benefit than the potential problems to manage. It is clear that sometimes, you have the factory team is always the team that people expect to be fighting for championship win and having the best riders. Last year, going back to your to the part of your question, it was not an easy decision between Enea and Jorge. We know Jorge is a super talented rider. This we know since we signed him and he was in Moto2. Then he had the accident in Portimao, which was obviously a big one. And before he would fully recover, it took some time. On the other side, Enea had a fantastic second season, you know, winning four Grand Prix. And obviously we came to a point when we need to decide, and Enea was fighting for the championship, winning already winner four times. And, you know, we took that decision, which we don't regret. We're just unhappy of what happened to him in the first race and then the additional crash and the injury in Barcelona. But Jorge has got exactly the same chance. He has exactly the same material, exactly the same updates, and he's doing a fantastic job. So obviously, you know, we'll see. It's interesting in a way. I'm pretty sure that the Grand Prix in Germany without Pecco and Jorge would be a kind of boring race, I'm sorry to say. And because they were leading with a big gap from the others, but you know, with them fighting, it was just so exciting. And you can see that they try to beat each other, which is obviously what we expect, but they never did something incorrect.
Just a little kiss.
Yeah, well, but it was, you know,
it was fun.
It was not like something deliberate, okay?
Yeah, no, it was it was a wonderful race, that one. Yeah. And it must be very satisfying, like you said, with the Sachsenring having been your nightmare track, to then see two Ducatis just leave everybody behind. But do you think, just to kind of a off-topic slightly question, do you think Pecco's hand-to-hand combat, close fighting on track skills are underrated sometimes by the world?
Well, I think in general, for whatever reason, he has been underrated.
You'd go in general.
Yeah, in general. Okay, some people, all these, sorry to say, bullshit about the team orders, which was...
You're allowed to say that on here, don't
you? last year, like people were saying, well, I know it was not true, and I know that he did that comeback from minus 91 thanks to him and this and the team, and that's it, full stop. And if you see the number of, because people don't care about statistics, and it's fine, I mean, people talking on social media or, you know, or at the bar, they have a different analysis. But if you look at the number of laps led by rider last year, maybe I'm wrong, but I think Pecco was leading like 280 and Fabio like 96, and the rest. So I mean, if you check that, you clearly know that the rider has been led so many laps compared to the second best, is doing a fantastic season. Probably Pecco's character is a little more calm. He's not really...
this is why we love Marco in the press conference with
Yeah, because Marco is outspoken. He doesn't mind about saying things that you shouldn't, maybe saying when it's... an official press conference, but you know, and Pecco is different. Pecco is from my same region. I'm from Torino, he's from Chivasso, which is about 10 kilometers from Torino. We are less extroverted, if you can say that in English, or more introverted, respect to the people coming from Romagna, from the Rimini area, and so on,
who are motorsport valley.
Yeah, we're different. Okay, a little bit different. It doesn't mean that, you know. And I like the fact that nobody's trying to. We don't want to change a character of a rider. First of all, you cannot, and you cannot do something fake. You cannot ask the rider to be, you know, making super funny jokes if he doesn't feel it comes natural to him.
Yeah,
it's different riders with different characters. I think the good thing is that if we talk about Pecco and Marco, they have a lot of fun together. They you see in the before the podium what do I say to each other.
And also after the podium with Marco. Sorry, who second.
Yeah. So you see, it's good. I think I like this. I like riders who have full respect of each other, and then we try to beat you know, the teammates, or you know, without doing any, I say,
over ambitious overtakes. No,
yes, exactly.
So yeah, I always think of the race in Aragon with Pecco versus Mark.
Yeah,
when his defense was so good, but it was almost just letting Mark Marquez attack and then just ignoring it. It was like poetically, it was a great mixture of styles. But then when we saw them this year, was it in Le Mans?
Mm-hmm.
When they all came out after the race and said, this is the way we want to race, mm-hmm. elbows out, maybe a little bit more nervous for those of you watching.
Yeah, as you know, it's we always nervous when there is a situation like that. Obviously, Aragon was incredible because Aragon is a place where Mark is super strong, and to see Pecco to keep his nerves calm in a situation like this, with Mark passing and Yuri passing again and so on, was maybe one of the best victories from his career with Ducati, in my opinion. At least was very emotional for us, and it's good for spectators. We still have the same problem with the stomach. At least myself, I have a butterfly in the stomach or
yes,
whatever.
Exactly.
Yes, okay.
So we could also, when you were saying about the being less extroverted, I think Davide is probably the greatest example.
Yeah, you see, put Davide and myself next to each other.
We love it at the end of the race when we get the shot of the box when you win, and you're just like, great, and then Davide's just having his own little one-man carnival.
Yeah, you see, exactly. Davide is from Romagna, same as Marco Bezzecchi. I am from Torino.
Well, we love the mixture. Everyone's character is different.
Thank you.
But I'll leave you soon to get on with the rest of your Indian Grand Prix. But what do you think now? The flyaways, it's crunch time, as we say in English. Mm. Completely different position to last time. And the person who's now chasing you, Pecco, in this situation, is another Ducati, and then another Ducati.
Mm-hmm.
Is it a bit more relaxed this time around as we're heading through Asia?
Yes and no. Obviously, let's say it looks likely, even though, you know, there are still many races that most probably it will be a Ducati rider winning the championship, the Riders' Championship. But obviously then we need to see how it will develop in the next races. Obviously, as you know, it's a very kind of hectic calendar because we have so many races, one after each other. So
and
it's
777 points up for grabs.
Yeah, so as I said, you know, even riders who are fourth and fifth, you know, still have a good chance to become again competitors for the championship. As it looks today, we are in a very strong position, but we still keep our feet on the ground because, you know, racing is racing, anything can happen. So we just want, and with all these races in a row, a small mistake can be very, very, very.
Like that crash in Barcelona.
Yeah.
Obviously, luckily, no harm really done.
Yeah.
I loved Pecco's choice of the word booty to explain where he'd got bruised from it. But what seemed like it could be a seriously dramatic moment in his title fight, unfortunately, it was Enea in the end, who's got a couple of things he needs to heal from that Turn 1 incident. But that must have been quite a, I don't want to say experience, like it implies it's good.
No, it was shocking because, you know.
It's a crazy moment for you guys when you see that.
When you see that kind of crash and you see all the bikes and you see Binder who tries to avoid Pecco but is just jumping on his leg, then you say, okay, the championship is over. What you would think is an injury similar to the one that Alex Rins has had and he's basically been out so many races. So in a way, it's a kind of, well, I don't like to speak about miracles because miracles maybe will be for something else, but it's a kind of miracle that he got bruises everywhere, but no broken bones. And maybe, I hate to say this, but probably the fact that five bikes were out on the first corner avoided that some more bikes coming from behind.
You're saying that in your position, because we looked at that and were like...
I mean, it's true. I mean, I don't say I'm happy because I'm not happy. No, I don't. It was all Ducatis anyway, and Enea got injured. But sometimes things happen in a certain way, and then you can say, okay, it's very bad, but it would have been worse if all these bikes would come, because then the possibility to hit Pecco and also to hit it somewhere else in his body, which would make even much worse consequences. So I think we're happy he could race even with a leg which is all the color of the rainbow, but he could race in Misano, get to third position, limit the damage in a way in the championship, and here, even though he's not 100%, he's definitely better.
It's like a reset. Yeah. And he was still one of only three current riders who managed to beat Dani Pedrosa.
Yep.
Which is an interesting...
Well, Dani, incredible. I mean, I saw Dani on Sunday night because there was an Alpine Star party. It's for their 60-year celebration in Riccione, and I spoke to him, and he's... I say, luckily, you are not really the best in the heartbreaking. I said, I'm good, but Pecco was better. And obviously, he's such a gentleman. I didn't want to try anything stupid and ruin...
A rider who also understands the consequences of other people's...
Yeah, and I mean, he's probably, if there is a gentleman in the generation of past riders, I would say Dani is one of those.
Well, that's a quite random but very nice note to end on, I think. A little bit of Dani Pedrosa love after I'm sure everyone enjoyed seeing him return last weekend as well. Well, Paolo, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
So glad to see you've enjoyed India so far. Let's see what Bud International Circuit has in store for the 8 Ducatis you've got out there.
Yeah.
And thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Best of luck for the rest of the season.
Thank you. Finger crossed.
Yes.